churches right there involved already.
The other two items we're going to do.
Okay, that'd be great. Thanks.
That's great. To do it justice, I need a
March, January for child athletic, and in the primer and sometime in May, but we'll get that information to you within the next couple of weeks. Appreciate it.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
Appreciate the input.
Try to make it to the top of the mountain. Then Boulder, and then came back. Yeah, that's what Montezuma's castle is.
3, 2, 1. Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the board meeting. I'd like to call this to order at this time and start by introducing our board members, Kelly Kelscher, Ann Bauer, Linda Yu, Kurt Karbuski, Paul Kenney, myself, Bob Green, Superintendent George Mavrolas, Annette Ashley, Sean Hyland, Todd Smith, Assistant Superintendent Sherry Syrah, and Lori Ames is actually representing the board at a meeting in Cross Plains. So first of all, at this point in time, we'd be looking for approval of regular minutes of August 28th.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions, any concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Communications, citizen comments. Have lots of citizens here. Welcome to all. Anybody have anything they want to bring to the board, either on the agenda or not on the agenda? Okay. If you do have something you'd like to bring to the board, you're certainly welcome to submit it in writing. Correspondence, board communications, board members. Yes.
Just wanted to mention a couple of quick things. On August 31st, I was able to go to the Glacier Creek sixth grade back to school night, which was geared towards for parents. I think Kelly went also. Great presentation. A lot of great information. Great chance to meet the teachers. Very well done. Good turnout as well. Also appreciated the fact that they did it before school started this year instead of after school had started. Made it a little logistically easier to kind of get a better feel for what's coming up. Second thing I wanted to mention to the board, just wanted to inform the board that I did recently receive a request from a member of the Madison area print media for an interview. They did target me apparently because I'm from Area 3 and the subject of their story apparently is some of the neighborhoods that fall within my area of representation, board representation. I have not agreed to, agreed to an interview. I'm still trying to find out more about what this reporter is seeking, you know, what the topic is. And I did notify Bob as soon as I received the request. I'm also working directly with Perry and with George and trying to figure out what the gist of the request is. And we'll, my intention is to try to help this reporter out. I think it's important that we as a district engage with requests like this. I think it builds good relations, and I think we need to do that. But by the same token, we want to find out more information before we proceed, make sure that we're directing them to the right person, you know, whether it's me or somebody else in the district, to get their questions answered. So I'll bring more information later when I get it, but that's kind of the status of where it is now. I have not heard back from this reporter yet. So.
And just as a quick follow-up, Kurt was nice enough to let me know about it right away. And I mentioned just to him as we start moving closer to referendum, as well as being in the public eye right now, this is the time of year where newspaper reporters, print reporters as well are looking at. We do also have a candidate who's running for governor who happens to be, you know, the head of the Department of Public Instruction. So there may be some more requests for interviews from our district since we're lightning rod on some of the issues which could affect that. So first of all board members have the right to speak. They have that right to speak. But, you know, on the other side, you need to balance on what it is that they're looking for and what they want. And so it's obviously my suggestion would be is to work through George or work through myself, not telling you not to. Just keep in mind we're trying to move towards a referendum, and obviously the less controversial we are in our communications with the press at this particular time, the better chance we have that. But again, you're all individuals. You certainly have the right to speak with anybody and everyone. So I think that's kind of what I...
Yeah, and I should just clarify too, if at some point in time it becomes appropriate for me to be the one that this reporter interviews, I would, of course, assure the board that I would make it very clear that I would be speaking on my own behalf for me as an individual and not representing the board as a whole or representing the district at large. So I would make that very clear if the time came to engage a little more. So that's all I have at this point.
I did want to thank, and, oh, go ahead, Todd.
I just want to mention, y'all saw my email following the all staff. I just wanted to reiterate again, I really love that event. It's such a great event. You got the teachers and the staff there. It is such an empowering crowd and such a positive atmosphere. It's one of the things I enjoyed most about being a new board member last year, and I enjoyed it again this year. You saw my comments about George's presentation and the other presentations too, but I mean, it is a the reason I took the unusual step, and I hope you understand why I sent the email, it's unusual, but I just thought it's one of the most important, in my mind, moments, because it's one of the few times I imagine that George, as a superintendent, can stand up in front of everybody, talk about the things that we talk about in this room and our goals and our objectives, and really reinforce all of those things. So I think it's a really crucial moment in the school year for our district, and I just thought it was a great day. George did a great day. Bob did a great job, and that was fantastic. So I you know, normally we don't send emails like that, so I want to just explain why I did it. That's why. I thought it was just what a great day and what a great presentation and on an important day. That's all.
And then I just wanted to second that. I thought, Annette, I really appreciated you did a really nice job. Kind of dry and boring when I speak. Who could speak from a different perspective? And it was a very nice job.
Even though you set a timer.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, wasn't that unusual?
Bob's got the hardest job because he has to do some nuts and bolts things, and then that can speak, has the freedom to speak from the heart. So
he did a very nice job. Even though you did get, we never did figure out where that came from, did we?
Just to explain, I was giving my comments, and all of a sudden over the loudspeaker there was a voice that came. I think it was like a kind of like a Siri voice that just sort of like, you know, and I had no idea what it was, and I said, did I exceed my time? And everybody laughed, but then I said, Bob, did you really set a timer? And everybody really laughed, so it was kind of, it was one of those moments that everybody laughed at, and we moved on just fine, and yeah, it was kind of funny.
And then, George, you said we weren't going to have the band.
I didn't know.
He works miracles.
Yeah, hey.
So if you want to give a quick explanation of how that worked out.
I wasn't going to impose on the band members and the band directors for a second consecutive year, but it was true. At about 10 to 10, Doug Brown was in the PAC, and I told him, I said, you know, a lot of people asked, you can have the band this year, you can have the band this year. And I said, no, you can't have them every year. I mean, you know, these poor kids, they got jobs, they got other things going on. He said, well, they're right outside. Do you want them? I said, really? He said, yeah. And I said, okay. I said, can they play some Bruno Mars? And he said, yeah. I said, okay. And that's what happened.
Ten minutes later, there they were.
Only the superintendent could make that happen.
There you go.
They were having their marching band camp.
They had their band camp outside. I didn't
even realize
it.
The same thing as the flash mob that my son said he was involved with?
Yeah, that was, he was there, yeah. Yep.
But again, I will reiterate, it was a wonderful meeting. I sat down and had something to eat in the cafeteria, and I was approached by many people, park staff as well, thanking not only for the speech, but also the care that administration has been taking. I know it's appreciated. Okay, any further board communication? Oh, we do have one other thing. George has sent off a note, WASB building trust by listening to your employees was accepted.
Yes.
As such. The next steps on that will go, first of all, is Joellen was nice enough to say that she would participate in that.
We got approved.
Yeah, we got approved. So Joellen is graciously accepted to be there. In the spirit of how this is going to work, George and I were talking about this, and we'd actually like to further develop the agenda with the input from other board members. We'd actually like board members who are attending the WSB to be a part of this, kind of very similar to what we do already when we have the listening sessions and break it up into groups like that. So we can show that our listening sessions work. We have the we have the hard data to show that it works, we have the anecdotal data to show that it works. But I think to really show other people how it works, it's important that we actually have the people who do this work, and that's the board members themselves. So if there would be an interest in the board members who are participating at WSB to be a part of that class and actually help us develop some of that agenda, George and I will set up a time. And then either do it before a board meeting or something like that, at half an hour, 45 minutes. We'll have some things fleshed out, but we certainly like to get input from everybody.
We don't have our day and time assigned yet, but that doesn't matter. It's either Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday of that WSB week. So I really like the idea of maybe giving some overview, large group, but then breaking into small groups where board members can have a small group and answer questions and facilitate, and Joellen can help with that, and Bob and I, and whoever else. So we want it to be very inclusive, innovative, and inspiring. I couldn't resist.
So anyway, that's kind of where we're going with this. And even if you're not going to attend it, but wanted to come up just for that and be a part of that presentation, we would certainly welcome that as well.
Yep.
But again, I'm there with George. We both talked about this going, there's no better way to do this than actually having the people who have actually made this work be a part of the presentation. Well, we do have Joellen.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Before it came.
But if we do have, I don't know. It's a good point, George, if you have some suggestions.
Sure. We'll brainstorm. Good news is we're selected.
Yeah, we got the hard part done.
Hard part's done.
So any other further board communication? We do have a placeholder, the legislative update. I don't know if anybody's heard anything more. And Todd, we don't know where. I know that they're moving forward on the budget, but I haven't heard anything more yet. Okay. At this particular point in time, we're going to move to consent agenda.
What about my report?
Oh, my apologies. Superintendent's report. Just poof, bat me out of there. Go for it.
Okay. Wow, it was an amazing first week of school. Had a chance to go into Jody's room. I had a chance to go over to Clark Street, met with Monica. I'm just kind of looking out. And actually had the great fortune of getting into all of the buildings. And that's the absolute, I wish people had my job on those days, because it is the very best. It's the best of the best. And I just want to thank everyone for the great start, the kids, the students, the families, everybody pulling together. But then we just roll up our sleeves and keep on going. So tomorrow, we're with our EUA and Findorf partners for all morning, and we do that every 2 to 3 weeks, where we're going to further define the expansion options that we've been working on, our communications plan. And so that work continues. It's kind of just layered over the top of everything else, but it's really, really important. So that's tomorrow. Wednesday, we are about 10 or 12 of us from District Services Center. We're joining the City of Middleton for the United Way community event that the city is hosting, and with some outside speakers, and just really trying to pull our community together to help all families in need. So that's really exciting. And then on Friday, Mr. Percy Brown pulled together. We kind of said, Percy, what should we call this? We're calling it the Middleton-Madison Coalition. It's basically the same group that pulled together the Crossings picnic event. We're pulling those same people together so we can continue our work and our partnership and our collaboration. And so that meeting will be held Friday here at DSC. So those are just some of the highlights of the week ahead.
Busy start. And then I think Annette, when she gasped when it hurt as well, third Friday is next Friday.
Yeah, third Friday is next Friday. You're going to get a nice report from Sherry in a few minutes. You'll see. We have more students than we anticipated.
So a blessing and a burden in both. You know, it's good to have more students, but then
we welcome them all.
We welcome them all, but now we have to figure out where we're going to put them.
Right.
So obviously, I think I remember talking with some teachers from Park, and we talked a little bit about our increasing enrollment, because obviously Cross Plains is a growing area. And, you know, kind of talked just very briefly about one of the main reasons people are coming to our district is because of our teachers and our staff and our administration, the programs that we have in place. And because of that increase in enrollment, it also allows us to have some extra funding to allow us to do things that we couldn't do before. So I just wanted to say thank you again to teachers that are here as well, to all of them. we couldn't be the district that we are without your help. And because we are a destination district, it's because of the teachers that we have here, obviously administration. But it's the teachers, paraeducators, the employees that we have bring people to this district. It's not the buildings, it's the employees. So again, I just want to start that out with, thank you. You know, we couldn't be where we're at without your help. Thank you again for a good start to this year, George.
Thank you all.
Okay, now, it's okay?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Consent agenda.
All right, for your consent agenda, for your approval, I offer 5A approval of bills payable, two approval of treasurer's report, 2016-2017, looks like we got page 13 and 15. And then B, approval of resignations as well as an addendum at your desk. Three, approval of staff appointments as well as an addendum at your desk. And I don't have any other further consent items this time. Looking for a motion?
Motion for approval.
Second.
Questions, any concerns, any items that you want pulled or discussed? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, now comes the fun part.
Yes.
All right, items for the information discussion, Park School Pollinator Garden Donation.
And I think it's so timely, Bob, that after the gratitude that you just shared, this is a project that we're excited to share with everyone here. You're talking collaboration between teachers. We're talking high school students working with elementary students. We're talking an amazing community member providing support to make it all happen. And so this is the best of the best. This is what makes us unique. And so really our first report of the 17-18 school year is our Park School Pollinator Garden. And yes, high fives around. I'm gonna turn over to Jody, Heather, Mike, Monica. It's all yours, come on up.
You're gonna stand?
Kids, families, I know we've got a wonderful presentation here.
So I'm gonna try and be like Annette and like speak from the heart. But I also have some notes because I don't want to be like up on stage and forget to thank the important people. So I guess I'm going to introduce the idea of the grant that I wrote was called Dream Big. And I came up with the idea, and it was kind of before the inclusive, inspiring, and innovative. But Monica, I put it all together, and then Monica was looking through it, and she said, okay, this is good. You work backwards. Now, what else can we add? And so we looked backwards, and that really, truly is what it kind of became. It was very open-ended, which is the inspiring part, because we all had a say. I wrote the grant to hope that the community members, my students, these are two of my past students, I'll introduce them in a moment. And then Heather was just a happenstance, and that was a good happenstance for me.
Good question.
Yeah, it really was. Things are put together for a reason. And then, of course, Mike, who I will not forget to thank publicly, because without him, we really would not have what we have. I posed the question to my students about what is it that you would like an outdoor learning center at Park School to look like. And we had some ideas. We floated them around, and we kind of came up with something, and then I talked with Heather. And we all know that research shows that being outside is good for so many things, attendance and health and wellness. And it is my heart. It is where I love to be too, that is mine. And Park School is just the epitome of what outside education could look like. We just have so many great outdoor spaces. So the wellness activity, I'm gonna let Heather take it from here. Before I do, I'm just gonna introduce, this is Addie and this is Colt, and she'll introduce them again.
Yes, absolutely. So I've been lucky enough to know Jody for quite a long time because my two sons went through Park School. And so we have known each other for quite a while. We were out on a trail walk in the school forest at Park for one of the wellness activities last year. And we started discussing how can we get kids out there. I really enjoy bringing my own students from Clark Street out to Park and trying to give back and you know reinforce some of those themes of being outside and taking advantage of the environmental aspect that Park really reinforces. I want to make sure that our high school students get involved with the younger students because I know that the more that you teach something, the more likely you are to remember it. And so I appreciated the opportunity to just talk with you a little bit while we were up there at the top of the hill, the school forest, and saying, hey, you know, what can we do to get the kids together again? So we were coming down the trail and Jody was saying, well, you know, I have this idea. I think we need another garden out here, you know. I think that maybe we can do something with this space. And I said, well, you know, I'm going to teach biology in the spring, and that's a really great time to grow.
It was just, I have this money, we're going to do something with it, it's going to be outside.
Yeah. It was a really great coincidence because I had a student teacher at the time who was well-versed in the environmental sciences, biology, and farming. And so she was very interested in her independent time, which happened to coincide with when we were going to do this garden, being something related to biology. And she loved the idea just of supporting this. So I love the idea of seeing a new teacher, seeing the importance of partnering with other teachers and with other grade levels, mixing up different ages of students. Okay? I love the idea of using the grant opportunities and helping new students, my student teacher, to see that grant opportunities can help you do things in the classroom that you might not otherwise be able to do. And I love the idea of getting our kids outside and giving them chances for leadership. And that happened at your age level and at the high school level, which was really great to see. And I met my goal of trying to give back to the school that helped raise my kids. You know, for my goals. Becca and Jody and I then met to kind of, do you want me to go into our process or do you want to introduce? I'll go into the process.
Go into the process.
Okay. So we met to talk about logistics, and what we were really interested in was trying to see how much ownership we could give to all of our students of this project. Okay, we wanted to be facilitators rather than owners. So we met and we were trying to figure out how could we increase student agency. And we were brainstorming around how could we help students select what groups and what portions of the project that they really wanted to work on, like choosing the plants and designing the layout, incorporating the art, lots of different things. And these two little people are going to talk to you about that in just a minute. My students came into the classroom, my classroom, and they were working with my student teacher, Becca, to create lessons around pollinators and plant-pollinator relationships, native plants versus invasive species, and how they could teach this to the third graders. One of my favorite moments in this entire project, I think I mentioned this to you, but I might not have, was actually the day when my students were trying to figure out how do you actually teach things to other people effectively? What does effective teaching look like? And so we had to stop. It wasn't about pollinators. It wasn't about this small page thing. It was really about what does good teaching look like? And so we did this brainstorm, and all of these things were up on the board, and I was like, okay, great, great. They really understand that they need to do things differently in order to teach people that are a little bit younger or people that are a little more active or people that, you know, don't want to read. There were all kinds of different activities in the groups that they were designing. It was great to see. And my principal just happened to walk in, which is even greater. let's see. So I'm going to let you guys talk a little bit about how we incorporated movement and how we were building community. So Addie is going to talk first about projects inside the classroom. And
so the first, in one of the classrooms, we were doing an interpretive dance and learning about, how they come and pollinate each flower. And in theirs, when they were doing the interpretive dance. And then we did, rock, paper, scissors, where we started off as an egg, and if we won, rock, paper, scissors, then we would move to a caterpillar, and then if we won again, we'd move to a chrysalis, and then if we won the last time, we would be a butterfly.
You need your notes for that.
Then in the last classroom, we colored pictures of butterflies, eggs, and caterpillars. So they helped us plan about the shaping of the butterfly garden and the path and what plants and everything. and told us and they also helped us learn why we were building the pollinator garden for pollinators to get pollen or to pollinate plants, because without pollinators, plants couldn't grow, and to also have a calming place for us. And so the whole school also made artwork for the pollinator or garden, the pollinator garden. And there was all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm. And they will continue to make art. So part of the grant I use to purchase items that the art teachers will then use in the art classroom. So every student at Park School will have some piece of art in the garden as well by the end of the year.
So after we have these additional... initial classroom settings, then we kind of went our separate ways for a little while, and Jody worked with her students and you worked a lot of magic, putting a lot of time in finding materials and resources and who was going to do what and when they were going to do what, and with Mr. Vina's blessing on all of it, right?
Most of it.
Most of it. And then we went into our classroom and we talked about, okay, how can we help? It was really about, all right, what can we do to support this project from there? So I'll let you talk about what happened after that.
So then, back up a few steps, I went over to Mike Gallagher. He's a family friend. He owns Capital Sand and Gravel. And I said, Mike, I have $2,500. This is the idea we kind of came up with. What can you help me do with that? And he's like, well, what do you want to do with that? And I said, well, the kids and I and Clark Street kids were thinking maybe like a pollinator garden, flowers and path and... or maybe just flowers. And he's like, okay. And he was all in from the get-go. And I think from the get-go, he wasn't going to take a single penny. And I love that man. And his son helped also. Like, their whole family is just a blessing to mine and now to our district. So here goes some things. So our staff got together after school and rolled down that yard fabric that after my son John came and dug out, which if I go back with you, you can see. This is what it looked like before. This was before the day, and then after the day. And you laid the yard fabric. And by the way, you can see the results. Mike was so generous and also so like willing to accommodate the schedule, the timeline that we were on because of the end of the school year. So this is the path, and it was really, really wet that day. But he laid the path, the sand path. This is him dumping boulders and the stone that we used the whole path. This is my car full of plants. This is, so not only did we get some of the Clark Street kids, but then I took a picture of this young lady. She is part of the after school program. She is the, tell me at my house, what is her title? She's the lawyer. She's the lawyer for Kids Safe. Yeah. So she came out, and I had both her kids, and her kids are way grown. And when I told her I was doing it, she's like, I'm coming. I said, yes, you may. And the kids working really hard when the Clark Street kids came. What day do you call that when the kids came?
Spark days. Yeah, we have days designed when our kids are out and doing things that enrich what they're learning. So
some did the back-breaking work and some did the planning part. They're making stepping stones, and these guys are making these beautiful plant markers that are in next to the plants that are there in the garden. And nothing can be complete without a project from Mr. Peanut. So at the end, when you see the arbors, he's grinding off some of the extra coal that doesn't fit inside the arbor to get it in the ground so it won't blow away. He pulled, I think that's easy. We're busy watering before we could plant, and we had to go out and water.
Thank you.
professional gardeners there. Here's Mr. Mike and I. And there's Abby, and that's her dad, and that's his mom. So it's a generational thing right here. That's beautiful. Hardworking. We had classes up there. Here's the arbor. It is really gorgeous. If you ever get out to Preston, please come look at it. Magical place for kids, like Colton's up there, just go and have a peaceful moment. And we really do, like George said, that innovative, inspiring, inclusive. We really feel that, like at Park School, we eat, sleep, live, breathe, hopefully do that stuff for our kids. We need to know that. So I don't think there's anything else I want to say except I can't thank Mike enough.
Well, we want to thank Mike as well.
And I want to also say Monica, and Kevin Martin, who used to be the school secretary, there's some garden art hanging on the front part of the arbor that he made, and that is a piece of work. Like, that's just a beautiful piece of work. You need to just come out and see that. Pictures really don't do it justice. And then I want to thank Monica and Kevin.
We'd like to do is publicly recognize Mike. I know you put in a lot of effort, a lot of resources that you just did. You're a big part of that, and we want to thank you. And so Bob and I are going to come out, and actually, if we could get just a quick group picture, I'd love the two kids to join us.
Yes.
And let's thank Mike. Seen it, go see it before the weather turns. It's really, now it's a great time to get out there. So,
and what a wonderful thing for our kids as well. So, again, much appreciated.
I don't want to take up any of your time, but when Jody first approached me with this idea, I said there was never a moment's hesitation. Yeah, go ahead, do whatever you want to. We'll back you all the way. I wish 8 years ago that I had had teachers like this that took an interest outside of the classroom. What can we do outside to further the education of these kids? And this is what comes up.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I'm really grateful that my kids go to Park because of that outside experience that they get. I know that all of our schools are great, but I feel really blessed.
Just on that point, every school has its own identity. Park has its own with its own forest and such as that. But it's things like this, which I think you mentioned the best. It's a quiet spot for the kids to go. You know, so it's a place that's on the playground where they can go, you know, get a little closer to nature and know it's something that they didn't have or a part of. So thank you for allowing our kids to have this experience. And most definitely, Mike, I mean, thank you. Personally, thank you. Really appreciate it. Yeah,
thanks. That was a good time. There you go. Yes, yeah, perfect time. That's kids probably have to finish their reading for tomorrow. Bye. Thank you for bringing your daughter.
Thank you
so much.
Okay. facility planning, branding, and update timeline.
Yep, Kristen and Andy.
Yes.
Take it over.
There is no top in what we just saw there, so just know that right away.
Gonna wait till you look most awkward.
Yeah, right. From the closest
get
eyes.
Get you back for all of those photos.
No problem. I know, me too. I'm always like trying to get a picture.
Well, some of you know you're gonna be in more photos than others just because of where you're located. So Paul's been smart to hide way back there. So. Evening, everyone. So I think you know Kristen Milsna. So we're gonna, and actually she's gonna handle the majority of this presentation, but we wanted to give you an update about what the communications team for the facility planning group has been doing over the summer. It's been a real productive, busy summer for us. So again, most of you are new, but if you remember in 2012, we had a successful referendum. And in the process of that, we had, if you will, a brand. And we called it Planning for Our Future, which subsequently then turned into Building for Our Future. At the time, we may not have thought of it this way, but it really was the first phase of what our long-range master planning is for the district. So rebuilding Cromery and adding on the wing and the other amenities to Glacier Creek, that's our first phase of what, you know, you will decide ultimately are all the other steps to this. So there were a lot of ways to measure the success of that referendum. I think probably the most obvious way is the fact that we passed it with 68% of voters approving the capital question and nearly 64% approving the operational question. But I think more than that as well is the fact that we set ourselves up going into the future. The fact is that, you know, Don and I, our spouses, often joked about being referendum widows during that 10 to 12 month process. But when we, in the course of the 100 plus presentations we did, what I heard from people is they really loved how transparent we were in the process, how much we shared with them. And we've continued to do that since the referendum's passed. The fact is that to come in on time and on budget, I think has impressed our community. The budgets that you've approved the last few years continues to show people that we're great stewards of their money. And that's important as we likely have to go to referendum again because of enrollment challenges and other things. So we look at what we've put together as really being, we wanted to bring it forward, if you will. And one of the reasons why, so first of all, part of this process was we asked a number of district administrators to help us. George was there, Sherry was there, others were there. What are the key words when we think about when it comes to the district and where we're going forward? And so these were the words that Findorf then used to kind of come up with what kind of tagline we might have, what kind of visuals we would have. And I won't say challenges, I think it is one of the opportunities. Since we passed the referendum in 12, one of the things that's changed is our district logo. And so while, again, I feel very proud of the work we did in the referendum in 12 and the branding that we used there, we wanted our new vision to represent the changes that we've made to be inclusive, innovative, inspiring, and then also those pillars of having the three, the look that mm-hmm. we have. So, Kristen can take it from here.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, you know, as Perry said, you know, we're at this critical stage right now where there's a lot of exciting things that are going to be happening in the Facilities Planning Committee. So we know that there's going to be a lot of outreach to the community. So we want to make sure that the branding was in order so that as we start communicating even more about that, people start to recognize that when they see something like this, they know it's about the facility planning. Because you as a district, and thanks to Perry, you do such a great job of communicating. So there are a lot of materials out there. So we want this to stand out a little bit on its own, but everything that we're doing is intended to complement the existing branding that's in place because it is very strong. So you'll see that it'll work really well together. So when you think about the district's old logo and then the district's new logo and then that referendum logo that turned into a logo that we used for construction, the one constant in there was a star, and that really represents so much of Middleton. So we really liked the idea of keeping that. We felt that that was just a strong representation of the district. We also, when we looked at some of the words that came out in conversations, there was a lot about like forward movement and this progression and always reaching for the stars. So that's the reason why there's this movement. The swoosh that you're seeing is really intended to visually show some of that movement. Although many people might not see it, we did intentionally put three lines so that it represented your three eyes. So you're going to see a couple indicators of that moving forward. So again, a lot of people won't notice it, but that was the thought process behind that. So that was the first graphic that we created that we thought could really start to build that brand. And then we wanted to look back at that tagline. So again, previously it was preparing for a future and then building for a future, as Perry said. So we took this concept of planning for our future. We liked, we talked about so many of them. There were probably, you know, like 30, 40 different taglines and different ideas. And do we put the three eyes in? Do we leave them out? So we talked about a lot of ideas, talked about those words. And we just kept coming back to something really simple that really represented what this stage is and then what that next stage will be. You know, should we you know, continue on with that referendum? And this really felt nice. It felt like a nice jumping off point from that last piece. So this is where we landed. So what you're seeing here, the new color of the Middleton branding is incorporated here. The district name is your district color, so we want to be purposeful to make sure that that color stays the same. But then we pulled a complementary red as well that we would use in some of these planning materials so that, again, it starts to just visually look a little bit different so that hopefully people start to recognize that as we're building awareness. So what we did then is we just started to think about the whole branding and, you know, style guide for it. So we came up with the colors. We talked about the placement. We can use the logo independently. We can also just use the words separately from that. So that's what you're seeing down here where you can just use those icons. Also the three eyes, we want to be sure that we're using those. We actually toyed with the idea of incorporating it right in the logo, but it felt like too much. And because they do stand on their own so prominently, we kind of liked the idea of maybe having those three eyes live somewhere on the communication pieces separately. So we'll show you some examples of that. So these were some different ideas. And then you're seeing in the lower corner as well, again, should we go to referendum, just played with some ideas of how might the communications evolve a little bit once we hit that stage of going to referendum. So that's a complementary graphic that could go along with this. So it would stay the same, but then we would start to introduce that vote and a date, should that be it. So just preliminary concepts right now. So there you're seeing some of those graphics. And then we wanted to show a couple of ideas of how this all comes together. So there's two pieces that we developed. One is a facility planning update. So again, really at a critical stage right now with the committee and looking at options. And this is where people are going to be really interested in what's happening. So we wanted to create a one-page summary sheet. So after each facility committee meeting, we can give a little recap. So Perry does a great job of doing this right now. But we wanted to have it include that branding so that if it's online, if it's in a hard copy format, people are starting to tie together that, oh, this is about that facility planning that they're doing. So we're building that awareness. So this document shows a couple things along the one column. There's upcoming dates so people at a glance can get some quick information, other meetings that might be coming up. We pre-populated this with some of the workshops for the community. And then you're seeing in the main panel a brief update on the actual meeting itself. So this would happen after every meeting. And then in the bottom portion of that is where we wanted to have some space so that we could put the board update. So moving forward after those facility committee meetings, the facility committee is going to come here and give you an update. And then you'll have some reaction to that. So we'll have a spot here where we can document everything related to that particular topic, and then this can be posted. So this is one of the tools we came up with, and then as you can see, the branding's all incorporated. I will say that the color looks a little off here, but I promise it's Middleton's burgundy that's there. So that's one tool that we created. And then the other one that I wanted to show you was the timeline. So you might remember, this is mine, so it has a lot of chicken scratches on it, but I don't know if you remember this timeline that EUA showed last spring. So this is the process, you know, now until a potential referendum. So we took that information and we just created it again in a look that would be in line with the branding that we did here. So we did, again, the information is exactly the same. We did reorder it a little bit, and the reason why is we thought it would be valuable for people to see visually what is the work specifically of the FPC, so that's in the real red color, and then below that, what is your role, and where are you getting updates, and how are you getting information? So we wanted to clearly identify that. And then we also wanted to make sure that people were seeing where the staff and the community were involved. So all of that information was on here. We just broke it out a little differently, just thinking visually it might help people. Again, this was a planning tool internally up until this point, where we feel like it's now at a point where we might want to start to share this externally. So this document right here, we designed it so that we could create a display board with it. So 32 inches by 60 inches long, which is a little bigger than a standard, but we thought in the district office it could be helpful. Maybe some of those schools that are feeling the crunch, it could be helpful to have it in their main, you know, front entrance. That's a possibility. The other thing that we did is we designed this display board so that on the very end, there's an acrylic pocket that adheres to the display board, and then those sheets can be in there. So all those updates, so we could update that regularly. So people could visually go up and look at this and understand it, but if they want to take more information or they want to remember exactly where to get more information online, we would make sure that that is filled. And really, this could stand on its own for a long time. So I think you'd get a lot of use out of it. Obviously, the timeline itself we can pull as just, you know, a handout like this too, but what you're seeing here is kind of more, again, thinking about how can we start to share with the community what's going on and give them a tool. So these were a couple things that we just wanted to work into that branding so, you know, we could start to see how it all feels together. Yeah, so that's where we're at right now, and we'll continue to use this look then on anything moving forward.
The plan would be then, the FPC has not seen this yet. Mm-hmm. We wanted to share it with the board first, then that they would see it at their September meeting, and then we would move forward with this after that. So that's our update.
I think it looks great so far. Just one question kind of popped up, and this is kind of a nuanced question, I guess, but what's the rationale? I'm sure there was, you know, it sounds like there was a lot of brainstorming that went into the phrase and the buzzwords or whatever, but why did they pick the word planning versus preparing?
You know, I think we talked about a lot of them. You know, we had used it before, the preparing. So I think part of it was, you know, showing, you know, that it's something different than what was done before. We are at that planning stage. There's a facilities planning committee. So it was just a word that I think a lot of us tended to gravitate towards more. It might just be where we're at right now and what we're calling the process right now. So you're right. There's a lot of different words that we certainly tried, and I think a lot of them can work. This just happened to be the one that stuck out to us the most, I think.
Might be off topic, so I apologize, but this is great. Should we add something to say why we're doing this, maybe, you know, dealing with our growth or something like that, just as a little slip in a little bit of advocacy there, so people, I mean, they, from viewing this, they can see that we've got a timeline and we're planning for our future, but just to remind people, the reason we're doing this is because of enrollment and growth and space challenges. Maybe that's a different point, and so it doesn't belong on this. I thought I'd just raise it.
I think that's a good point, and I'm glad you brought it up. I think messaging like that will definitely come as we're going through the process and we're really identifying those needs. That would be content that would be built into pieces. So as we move forward, instead of it really being right in that main tagline, I think you'll start to see those themes pop up. So when you start to see some of those updates and talking about key needs, you'll probably start to see maybe two, three of them that bubble up that we will absolutely highlight. So I, you will definitely see that moving forward.
And Todd, I would add that I think that's happening already too with a lot of the materials that we're sending out. I mean, and try to be abundantly clear where we were in 2012 with enrollment, where we are now. And again, as I've said to many of you many times before, I thought one of the most powerful messages we had the last time was the last buildings that were built by the district were in 1996 for schools. We had enrollment of 4,800. By 2011, we were at 6,200. I mean, I think that was a pretty powerful thing that people understood, and now we're at 70, Sherry will tell you, but we're at 73 plus. So again, the numbers tell a very important story.
And I think my question actually ties in very, very much with Todd's, because I guess the nuance of what I was kind of getting at is that, you know, this isn't, and this is the kind of the theme, the undercurrent, which we're going to need to convey to the community, is not, this is not things we'd like to do, or we're planning to do, or thinking about doing. These are things we must do, we have to do, we are going to do. So that's why I asked my question. I think that Todd's kind of expanding.
I guess I want to say I'm looking at this document and I'm seeing a very professional, very clean document. The people who will be looking at this document will come from all different sorts of life. There will be retired citizens living on a budget. There'll be just moved into community with kids and without kids. Professionals, businessmen. I mean, we're going to go through an entire gamut. So, I mean, you do run into a situation where you do have to be somewhat broad. I'm going to go on the other side, planning versus preparing. Preparing to me is one step, and then planning is the next step you do after you prepare. You're getting ready, and then you're actually moving to that next step on planning, and this is a step. This is a positive step for moving forward. Preparing, planning, not a lot of difference, but I can understand why you kind of move towards the planning side of this, because we're asking you for something now. We're already there. We're moving forward, and it's we're not just getting prepared. We're there. We're ready to start moving forward. So I'll just throw my two cents in. I like the star. that's pretty fun. Yeah. But it's got to be neat. It's got to be professional, because many times they're not going to judge you by what your words say, but how your presentation is. And I think you've done a nice job so far. So, I mean, we have eight other board members here, but I'm just looking at it at first glance, well above and beyond where we were the last time we went in a referendum. So this is a nice start. I can feel your presence in this one.
Kristen's group did a great job. Becca Anderson, I want to.
A quick comment about planning, and when I hear the word planning, you can hear like your brain is cracking, is moving, and thinking about what to do next. Where preparing maybe is just a one action, but you know I like the planning. Yeah.
One other thing, I like the fact how you separated out the three different action plans, so we can look at this and. Staff and communities at, and we know where the facility planning, and we know where we stand. Well, then it's easier for us to track and make sure all three groups are online, because if one falls behind, then we all fall behind.
I was just going to say, we had a chance to look at it. We did the exact same thing you're doing here for about an hour, planning, preparing, growth versus future versus, I mean, we went around and around and around, and then we landed on planning for our future. So good, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, moving right along. Equity work review. Percy.
We hope so.
Good evening, everyone.
Percy.
I'm a little tired because I'm expecting my first one any day now.
Wow. I don't know.
So I've been trying to train myself. Every time my wife gets up in the middle of the night to use the bathroom, I wake up and say, "Are you okay, honey? Is there anything that you need?"
You know, Percy, wait until the baby arrives.
I think I'm ready. I keep telling people I am, but everybody says, "Oh, you just wait and see." But you know, it's really exciting, considering, you know, when you have your first child, you're always thinking about, well, what school district are you gonna send your child to, right? And We currently live in the Madison School District attendance area, but that will be short-lived moving forward. But I'm very optimistic about where we're moving as a district, and I think that 5 years from now, when she'll be in kindergarten, or 4 years in 4K, I think this will be the district of choice for my daughter, considering my wife and I work here. So this will be kind of brief. I think I'd like to just focus on students tonight. I know you all had an opportunity to watch For the Record, and I had a chance to really talk about a lot of the work that's been going on with teachers and even some of the challenges that we've experienced over the past year because of the uptick of the national climate, you know, when it comes to issues of race and religion. But I would like to extend a thank you to Linda, Kurt, and Bob for being out at Elver Park when we had the back-to-school cookout. It was initiated by some staff at West Middleton, and kind of at the last minute, they looped Glacier in the high school in, and to see not only school board members, but district leaders, admin for the entire attendance area, a bunch of teachers just in the heart of one of our most challenging communities, not just in Middleton, but in Madison. We've been having community meetings in the Elver Park neighborhood where our kids live. The Madison Police Department is receiving more phone calls in that neighborhood than anywhere else on the west side. So that's the kind of challenge that, you know, we see at times when those kiddos are coming into our buildings. But to see the leaders and the teachers, you know, step outside of our district and our schools and to go into the community in a way where we were serving hot dogs and hamburgers and just having genuine and authentic conversations was really powerful, you know, for me. And to see Alderwoman Barbara McKinney there, Chief Koval from the Madison Police Department, other police officers, people from the city of Madison. I've never experienced anything like that as far as a parent engagement event. And Kurt, I want to thank you. When we were having the conversation, when I was like, man, I can't wait until next year for this to happen. And Kurt was like, well, why do you have to wait until next year? You know, why don't you go ahead and keep that thing going now? And from that, we now have a team of people from not only West Middleton, but select people from Glacier as well as Middleton High School that will continue to meet and be creative to offer and create opportunities to engage our families in that attendance area. And I think that the same will be duplicated for the Cromery attendance area. And that's why we have the meeting coming up this Friday with the Middleton-Madison Coalition team to see how we can strengthen our partnership and do more to serve that neighborhood, because those are our kiddos, even though it is the city of Madison. But just to kind of just stay on community before I go to students, I'm not sure if you are familiar with the Middleton Equity Team, but that's been going on for about 2 years now, and it's a great group of folks from Middleton. We have several clergy representing a lot of churches from the Middleton area. We've got representation from the Chamber of Commerce, the United Way. We've got the mayor, Gurdeep, and other city officials that are a part of the Middleton Equity Team, and then local community-based organizations that have representatives. And, you know, you talk about bringing all the stakeholders together with a focus to really meet the needs of all of our kids. It's just been phenomenal to see that group come together and work with the district to think about how can the community be more engaged, especially when we think about, you know, issues of poverty, issues of race, and not just our kids, but even the families in terms of employment, and just really trying to take a holistic approach to create this community of one has just really been impressive. But as far as student engagement, which is one of the pillars for our strategic framework moving forward, has just been phenomenal. You all have heard from the high school students several times, whether it was a debriefing of the spring break trip or just hearing about some of the phenomenal work that they've been doing in terms of engaging their peers around changing climate and culture, working with our teachers and district level leaders to change how we provide instruction, what we teach, and empowering everyone to really create a climate and culture that's inclusive, innovative, and inspiring, you know, the three I's. But we do have newly created positions that are in year two. We have student engagement specialists, one at the high school and two at our middle schools. And it's just a relief to have three powerful people that would be able to take what we've started at the high school and expand it district-wide, which now allows me an opportunity to engage more with the leadership team through the level meetings and in leadership teams so that we can start moving our entire system in a way that will better meet the needs of our kids. So what the three student engagement specialists have come up with is this overarching name of all the things that they will be doing, and it's called Justice League. I'm all about the super friends, right? But actually, LEAGUE is an acronym, which stands for Leaders Emerging to Achieve Greatness by Uniting Everyone. So if you think about the high school, we've talked about the affinity groups. We've got the Black Student Union. We've got Latinos Unidos. We've got GSAFE and Student Voice Union. But they also have a group where all of the affinity groups have come together, which is called the SEC, or the Student Equity Coalition. And they've been working with the high school admin and teachers and are continuing the great work that they've been doing. But there is a piece that will be taking place this year where we've been doing some kind of informal peer mentoring where we've had our high school students going to Elm Lawn. It was called Cardinal Buddies. There was some mentoring going on at West Middleton, and they call that Rise Up, but we've now done away with those names, and we're calling all of it Justice League. So we have representatives from each of the three elementary schools that will be served. So Sauk Trail will be included this year. So Sauk Trail, Elm Lawn, and West Middleton have staff that are working with the student engagement specialists to create curriculum. So we're really starting to systematize and add structure to what we've been doing, which is informal. So they will be having high school students on a rotation coming in and mentoring our elementary kiddos at the three respective elementary schools, and I'm really looking forward to that. And Dr. Plank and I have had informal conversations in terms of what does it look like to be able to offer the high school students credit for that type of service, even though we'd have to add some type of project or assessment at the end of the year. But to be able to offer credit for students that will be going in and working with our elementary kids, I think is something really, really, really powerful. At the middle school level, the two student engagement specialists will be creating a variety of after-school programs to engage students through enrichment opportunities. We've also been in partnership with UW-Madison with their partner schools network, and we have, I would say, probably 10 to 15 doctoral students that will be supporting the middle schools with some of the enrichment activities that will be taking place after school. And in addition to that, there will be targeted case managing where we will be looking at some of our tier three or our highest need kids, where those student engagement specialists will be providing, some really strong case managing and following up with families, following up with teachers, and make sure that we're staying on them so that they don't get too far behind. In a nutshell, that's what I'm really excited about as far as being able to engage our students in non-curricular type activities, which research says that if you get kids engaged in creative types of ways like that, that will increase their engagement in the classroom. And I just have to thank not only the school board, but the district level leaders as well as the building leaders for allowing the students the capacity to be able to do those types of things. Because sometimes that can be challenging when we hear from students because they speak their truth. And sometimes they say things that may kind of throw us off a little bit, but that also creates our greatest opportunity to be able to do things a lot differently. I've seen students be a part of the hiring process at the high school, whether it be for teachers or for administrators. They're always embedded into our professional development days throughout the district. We use them in our summer equity-based professional development. And man, I'll tell you, when you empower kids and you give them the space and the capacity, they can do so much. And these things aren't happening in any other school district, because we've been afforded opportunities to present about the work on the national level. And whether it was the National Alliance of Black School Educators Conference or the MSAN Conference or even AERA, we were at the American Educational Research Association presenting on our work, and the feedback has always been amazing. You know, they're kind of like, I cannot believe that you all are doing that for students and having the type of conversations that you're having. Even WIDA, which is a National Language Acquisition Coalition, found out about the work that we're doing, and we will be highlighted as a featured breakout session to talk about the equity work that we're doing in the district. So, you know, we've only been at this for about 5 years, and again, you know, last year was probably my most trying year as a professional. We had a few students that does not reflect our entire student body that put things on social media that didn't necessarily challenge my leadership role here in the district. But, you know, being an African American male from Madison with some level of success, when you are in that type of position, the black community will just automatically deem you as one of its leaders. And, you know, because of FERPA rights, we can't disclose how we handle issues with students, right? And because of that, you know, folks in the community thought that we weren't doing anything, and I made some comments, and I mean, I've never been attacked in the way that I was attacked this past year, whether it was from the incident with the girls' basketball game or even the Confederate flag. So it was rough, but you know what? Coming into this year, and it was really the cookout that gave me such high hope and optimism, and I let all that stuff go that I went through this past year and just threw it out the window and was kind of like what the Facilities Planning Committee was saying, you know, it's time to continue to move forward because we are moving in the right direction. And I just want to give kudos to George because of his framework. The leadership team, we're having the right conversations because all of this work that I'm talking about today is now going to be moving through a systems approach. We are really taking a deep look at our systems, what's flawed in the systems, what's working well in the systems, and I think we have a team of leaders that are ready to make the necessary tweaks, strengthen the things that are going well, doing away with the things that are not working well for students, and recreating a system and a structure where, as Dr. King would say on his last speech before he got killed, he talked about when he was at the mountaintop and he saw the promised land, or he saw the light. He saw an America that we're not seeing today. And, you know, I said it 2 years ago when I had a few minutes before the entire PAC. I said, if there is a place where a light can shine, where a light of optimism and hope in a community where there are no barriers based on race, there are no barriers based on poverty or what religion you claim, I really do believe that that place is here. And I can just say that from personal experience because I've never been afforded the capacity and the opportunities in my 20 plus years of working than I've had here. And I can take that and say, you know what, we can move this entire district forward. So I just want to say that I'm very encouraged. I thank you all for your support. Not only for myself, but just for the rest of the district leaders, and always supporting kids. I pay attention to your body language when the kids are here, even today, tonight, you know, when the little kiddos are talking, everybody was kind of like, wow, you know, and I'm like, how can I, you know, duplicate that? But even when the kids come in from the high school and talk, I can tell that you all sincerely care and that you're engaged, and to have the support of the board, again, it's just so encouraging and optimistic, and I can't thank you all enough for what you all have allowed to happen in the short time that I've been here, but I'm truly looking forward to what we have coming up in the next 2 years
and beyond.
So that's it in a nutshell. I know you all probably Feel free to have at it. Yes, sir.
Do you feel like you have enough resources to do what it is you want to do? Or do you feel that holds you back? And a second question, marginally related to that, if you had more resources, what more do you think you could do?
That's a really, really good question. You know, for me, the most valuable resource that you can have is the human capital. It's not necessarily about money for me, but more about unity and alignment under a common vision and a common mission, which should be to be inclusive, inspiring, and innovative, and really and truly meeting the needs of all of our kids. And, you know, I started with just 20 additional days as a dean of students, and I did that for 2 years, and then was fortunate enough to have you all unanimously approve the position that I'm in. And given the tight resources that we've had, district leaders have been creative to create positions to engage students in creative and outside of the box ways. Could I use resources, more resources? I probably could, but for me, you know, I would rather, you know, focus in on looking at where we are as a system and what's working well and what's not working well. So kind of going through a comprehensive needs assessment. And then at that time, thinking about what more do we need, because we may find that certain things may need to go, which will open up some resources. And then how do we reallocate those things to better meet the needs of kids? So for me, it's really about the kids, but I think I could probably better answer that question in a year from now, because I think the leaders are moving in the right direction in terms of really doing a deep analysis of where we are as a system. I knew that we needed some immediate resources in terms of, you know, diversifying our staff and doing some things to really, you know, get at kids that have been marginalized for, you know, for quite a while, and not just in Middleton but everywhere. But we've gotten some of those things in place. So for me, it really is about, okay, let's take a look at where we are now as a system, and then coming back to say, well, actually, you know what, maybe we can use one or two positions here. I hope that kind of
it does. I mean, with the referendum coming up, this is the kinds of things we're thinking about. And if it's possible to I don't want to get ahead of myself, but to incorporate your needs into discussions about what we should be asking for next, so a year from this November, I'd sure like to take that into account.
I really appreciate you planting that seed, because I will have that in my mind as we continue to move forward as a leadership team and redesigning our systems to better meet the need of all of our kids. So, yeah, I'll bring that back to you.
Great. Sounds good.
You talk about changing the systems, and I think one thing that I like what you've touched on tonight, which I, as I recall, you touched on quite a bit in your interview with Neil, was the whole idea of getting, instead of like the old days, you know, because one thing that I struggle with is like, what are we doing now, or what can we do now that we haven't been doing 10 years ago or 20 years ago or 30 years ago? And, you know, there's no simple answer to that question, of course, but I think one thing that seems to be a little bit different is giving the kids more ownership of what's going on and including the students more in the solutions, whereas the old days it's more like, you know, we're the smart people, we're going to come up with things and kind of put them down on the kids and that's going to solve all their problems. But really, I think the more you give kids, you know, and some of the things you've been involved with that you brought here and give briefings on before the board have shown how the more we empower the students themselves and get them involved, it seems like there's better results, you know, more bang for the buck in terms of their, I don't know, it just seems like there's better results with that.
It's been kind of interesting how we've kind of had a, not necessarily a top-down approach, but there's also been this kind of like bottom-up when you think about what we've been able to do for students, but also for teachers. And I think you're just going to be this point in time where we all come together. You know, that's my ultimate vision. I think the more that we can be aligned all the way across the board, whether it's our external stakeholders, our kids, our teachers, our administrators, if we can seriously align under, you know, this idea of a community of one, you know, I don't know how much money, more money we'll need, because it will be the changing of hearts, minds, and souls, where we're truly embracing one another, and we are not, you know, a district that's built on competitiveness, but community, and ensuring that everybody has an opportunity to fulfill whatever dream and aspirations they have for themselves. I would love to see that happen in Middleton, and I do believe that we have the right drivers in place. Now, will there be difficult conversations along the way? Absolutely. But we have to, you know, be courageous to engage in those difficult conversations, not be afraid to experience the discomfort while we're having those conversations. But that's just part of the progress. You know, in the words of Frederick Douglass, you know, he said, without struggle, there is no progress. And we're not facing anything like the 50s and 60s, where you had freedom riders from the North, you know, putting their lives on the line going in the South. It's just a matter of just being courageous in the space that we're in to consider doing things a little bit differently. But again, I want to thank George for, I think, acknowledging that piece, right? Because we've been able to use wellness and mindfulness at the district services team level and at the leadership team level with that particular focus to start moving us into this space to be able to have those types of conversations. And as we continue to do that, I do believe that we're going to come out unified. And once we're unified, I don't think there's anything that can stop what's possible for this district.
I'm sorry, it's been a tough year for you. You mentioned that. I just want to reiterate that, you know, the board is so appreciative of the work you do and your team does, and so supportive. And so no one likes it when those high profile issues happen in our community, but we've got the right people on the team. So thank you so much for that, and keep fighting the good fight, I guess. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Kelly, you're in. Annette? I think 4 years ago, I remember as you were talking and moving forward and going where we're programming, and I looked at this and I go, wow, where are we going? What's going on? And in the back of my mind, I had, okay, how many students do we have? You know, can we set up individual plans, and can we get kind of working on this? And you went at it from a completely different level, and which I truly appreciate as the years have gone by. You were looking for unconscious prejudices in the way our teachers were teaching, the way we were viewing things, working with teachers, making sure that our curriculum was changed. That's a much harder path to go down. It takes a lot longer to right the boat. You didn't go for the quick fix. What you went for was a systemic change. You've talked a little bit about that. That's a much harder path to go down. It's a lot harder to get traction. You know, we had George on board, we had administration on board. But I know you had many fights as you tried to make people understand, well, why do we need to do this? Why is this necessary? What we're doing, this is just working. But over the years, I've seen the changes, the things that you've been asking for, and where we're going, and it's all starting to come together now after a couple of years. And that's so important, because they're our kids. I mean, you've heard me say this more than once. It's our kids. And you're trying to do not only fix the problems we had in the past, but for future generations. They're not quick fixes, things that'll disappear after a couple of years. These are things that are going to stay inside of our district for a long time, but they take a lot longer. You don't get the accolades that come from the quick fixes, but you do it the right way. And I guess I just want to thank you for that, for doing it the right way, working inside our system, allowing people to understand why you're making these changes, fighting the fights that you had to fight to get to what you wanted. It's a lot longer process, but I can now begin to see where you're coming from and where you're coming at. And on behalf of other people as well, I just want to thank you for continuing to make this right.
No, thank you, and I think you really thank my dad and my mom and my dad's side of the family. They really instilled the idea of being a servant leader, and understanding that I'm serving something bigger than me, and it's always about every kids that was at the high school the 2 years that I was the dean, I'm sure they would say, you know, no, that wasn't Mr. Brown. No, I mean, I was at Tumble Down the other day and ran into the Bartleson boys. You know, their dad pulled up. He was like, are you Mr. Brown from the high school? I was like, oh, yeah, yeah. He's like, my kids are back there. They said they thought that was you. So I had a really good conversation with them, and they're white kids, right? So while I know we have to have focus on our marginalized population, which oftentimes are students of color, that's not to dismiss meeting the needs of our white kids as well. And that's just always been my philosophy and approach. But again, that comes from my daddy and my mom and those who came before me.
About to become a dad yourself, so pass it on. You're about to get a chance to pass it on to the next generation. So
I got a lot of babysitters back there. Dr. Plank, you still back there? Uncle Plank, Uncle Steve.
Remember that when you got 2 hours of sleep and you're going into work the next morning.
Yeah, looking forward to it. But again, thank you all for the time, and you all continue to do the great work that you've been doing.
Thanks for your leadership, Percy.
Okay, academic and career planning report. Okay, Laura and Jerry.
So we're going to hear a consistent and similar message to what you've heard all night, starting all the way to the park presentation. Everyone has heard since then, it's about empowering kids, giving them ownership in the process, and really just serving to facilitate the system and structures around them. Laura and I last year led a group that met repeatedly throughout the year, working on academic and career planning requirements that were put forth by the Wisconsin Department of Instruction. And 2017-18 is the first year that all school districts a long history to some of that work. Some of you may have been board members back when we had the career portfolio requirement, which some of those pieces kind of carried over again in the first place. But it's a different structure, a different focus, and a different core in the sense that it's more about what you're providing and serving and making available for the students than what you're requiring to do. So this is kind of that transition of how that has developed. Key pieces and a part of it that I led, and then I'll turn it over to the board here, who will also let you feel the curriculum and academic work and how that infuses those pieces, is the selection of what software system we're going to use. One of the things we discovered in the process of doing that work is some inconsistency in between what we were using in middle school and high school. So part of that was bringing those teams together, analyzing the pros and cons of each of those situations and systems, and then moving forward together.
I think that Career Cruising, one of the main reasons we selected it, besides that it's free now from the state, is that most districts are using Career Cruising, so kids transferring in will be coming in with that. The professional development support provided to our staff from the state that's also free is mostly the key component for us, because our Chamber of Commerce has been diligently working on what's an add-on to the Career Cruising program called Inspire Madison Region. And we met with the Talent Development Committee of the Chamber of Commerce last week, and they said that they had
had about 70-some businesses populating that. And what that is sort of an electronic communication system for both teachers and students so that teachers can ask for presentations from a variety of businesses through that system. But maybe more importantly, if kids use that Inspire Madison add-on through Career Cruising, they can access coaching, they can access questions of a wide variety of people in careers here locally. They can request a job shadow, they can have a mentor. So there's a whole lot of options for this this important component for our local business partnerships. So that was one of the main reasons we were like, well, you can't do that with Naviance, which is our other tool. And so Career Cruising is improving their system. We think if we can use it more richly across 6th through 12th grade, that our students will really benefit from that. What I want to share with you are a couple documents. So the document after kind of just the informational document, that's the ACP components, and that's actually a document from DPI. So what we did in our renewal process or our review process is we said, what are all the things we're already doing in the district that align with those activities under know, explore, plan, and go? And that's kind of the terminology that the DPI is using. And then so I have a document that's massive, that's a Google document spreadsheet from 6th through 12th grade that we're already doing in the district. But what we found was, not every student is getting all of those things systematically across our district, and that's where we just need to tweak it a little bit. So while this next, like I think it's 7 or 8 page document, is a pretty rudimentary Google Doc, what we wanted was something that kids could kind of make their own, and also something that teachers are already using easily with students. So it's essentially a Google Doc. Right now you're seeing the whole template, and like I said, it's kind of rough, but I'm currently meeting with teams of teachers across all those grades to talk about what are you doing that naturally fits with this. So for example, I met with a health team of teachers who seek all of our sixth graders right away at the beginning of the year. And they said that they're doing goal setting on personal wellness. That fits really well in our initiative is Rest, Eat, Move, but it fits in with kind of building some self-awareness and then setting some goals for your wellness. So it's beyond just academic and career planning. But this document will probably expand greatly over the years. And what kids can do is they can share it back with their teachers, they can share it with their parents, either through Google Docs or if they wanted to print out a section, they can really make it their own. And then what we're beyond sixth grade health, we'll be meeting with core teachers to talk about goal setting in a class, and then designing action plans to meet your class goal, and then kind of get more complex as you go on. So in some of the content areas and grade levels, we'll be talking about how do the skills that I'm learning now, how do those relate to my interests, talents, and aspirations? How can I build goals around that but apply back to my classroom? And then some of our student services staff whom I'll be meeting with this coming Friday will be talking about how they can plug into some of this both in parent meetings and in their meetings in small groups with students. So there's a whole bunch of people that I need to meet with before we kind of push this out to parents and say, start asking your children what they're doing with their academic and career plan. But the video was really a way to introduce that to all of our staff. And then to say, we just want sort of each grade level team of people to take one small part of this. But then feeling like if we just do that, then we'll have a systematic approach for all kids to access this multiple times a year.
Laura, I mentioned the student services staff. It ties in beautifully to the work you've done around the Wisconsin School more comprehensive counseling model and the individual learning and planning meetings that happen with parents and with students. So it ties beautifully into that as well. So that's some of those meetings that they'll be following up on, where they'll pull up these documents as well as career cruising, to be able to actually have students share where they're at, what they've done, what they've been able to see, and how that's helping them to determine their direction. And the part that I think is most interesting in the video as well is how much that direction will change over time, because we know it will change.
One thing I'll just add is that we have academic and career planning course for those of you who don't have eighth graders yet.
That course is fully comprehensive of all of this stuff, and it's probably the best course in the state. I mean, those two teachers have been actually helping the DPI and helping our district kind of know, and some of those teacher leaders are going to be also talking to their colleagues about kind of how easy this is to tap into and to help students develop their plans. What questions do you have?
Eight of them are kids in the district that will all have academic and career plans. You will be hearing about this in your homes.
An eighth grader, so yes. He has a second semester. I'm like, what is this?
And yeah. I was going to say, having had an eighth grader last year, it has really developed. I mean, just having older kids and then having an eighth grader come along, really great curriculum in that class. I would agree.
Yeah, and they were using career cruising really thoroughly, but then we sort of let it drop off in the high school because they started using Naviance at the high school level, which is a really strong program, but it's kind of hard when you're using two different programs and then kids don't really go back themselves to access it. We think this will be a lot richer.
What I love best about this approach compared to our previous approaches, this is not a hoop jump for kids. Mm-hmm. This is not a graduation requirement that you have to do this because we said so. Mm-hmm. This is designing process that has meaning to students and hopefully then connects to what they see themselves in the future. It's a service and structure for them, not something to them.
Well, I think this is important as we, in the past, we used to be site-based management many, many years ago, Lord. George was around when we did site-based. And one of the things that you had brought on board when, in terms of curriculum is you started aligning curriculum. So as there weren't transition points from elementary to middle to high school, and now what you're doing is the same thing here, is you're lining everything together so it's not a jump or from one plateau to another or with a different system and program in place. They don't have to learn anything new. They just keep doing what they were doing before. As we're beginning to see some of the classes we're seeing in middle school are classes that at one time used to be offered in high school. So we're beginning to see the merging of both the middle and the high school in terms of program accessibilities. And the fact that there's less of a transitional in terms of the kids' minds, it's obviously going to be easier for them. One less difficulty, one less hurdle they have to face as they're going through. So I appreciate that.
I think, Jerry, you said it well to begin with. Everything tonight is talking about kids having ownership in learning, kids having a voice. And that's where our engagement goal comes from. And you see incredible results when kids take active leadership in their learning. And the ACP, while it's and I said it at the presentation, while it's a state mandate, usually state mandates, you kind of go, oh, it's a state mandate. This is actually a pretty good state mandate because it's going to create some incredible opportunities for students and families and parents to get to know more about goal setting for their kids. And so it's really a good thing. So we have great leadership there, so thanks.
I just wonder how long can students access this career cruising? You said the system is free to use. Can they go back and check out the material?
I know they can while they're here. I think we've had a question about when they graduate, how long they have access after they leave. I believe they still have access as like freshmen in college.
I think they do.
We had talked about it, and there were multiple ideas that people were throwing around. There were some people that thought it was as long as there was still a state contract, they would have access.
well, they get introduced to it in sixth grade.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay. Enrollment update, getting towards the end of this process, aren't we?
Settled down in the registration office, finally. So numbers are updated. We won't have the official third Friday count finished until after Friday. I did run just an update this morning, and it was, we had a few shifts here and there, but the total K-12 building enrollment was exactly the same this morning as it had been on Thursday. So overall, you've got the actual enrollment, actual versus projected, no major shifts there. The total enrollment comparison trend shows where we were as of last Thursday morning. That puts us at 213 students above K-12 building enrollment last year, third Friday. The other piece, again, remember, we always drop a little bit at the beginning of September. I did have Tori Rady pull, both on Friday and then again today, just a list of any students who have not attended at all this year. There was only a total of 14. Four of them have excuses entered for reasons that they're not here. The others, I think it's quite possible that those are students who will end up withdrawn. And so that would be a potential little bit of a drop. So we anticipate we're on track to be about 200 students over last year's third Friday. How that rolls out between open enrollment, 4K, and things like that, then that's kind of Lori's piece to figure out the realities of that. As I mentioned last time, one of the other things I think where we saw a bigger shift was in 4K enrollment. It has held at 360, although two of those students we think might not show up are 4K, but either way, it's still our largest 4K class to date. And the projection from APL was 325. And so just that will then play out in what the APL projections look like moving forward after this year. So after the third Friday count is certified, Lori forwards that information to them, and they'll start working on projections then for 18, 19, and beyond. So we'll start playing around with that already for next year. But there weren't any major changes. I'm happy to answer any questions if you have them.
I think the bottom line, you know, Sherry and I talked, and once we get the third Friday settles in, Lori mentioned this at Finance, we're going to reengage Mark Roffers to see if there are any tweaks or adjustments, because if we're coming in at 200 and we projected 146, there's a ripple effect. And as Sherry said, that 4K number rolls into kindergarten next year, and it's our largest 4K. Well, the last time we had our largest 4K, we had our largest kindergarten.
Right.
And that's not what they're projecting in APL for next year. So,
And again, that largest 4K that became the largest kindergarten, I mentioned this last time, it's that first grade group now, which is 549. And so if you think about, you know, there's a grade progression each year that a class moves through our system. The fact that we have a 549 already at first grade suggests, you know, that number is going to grow significantly by the time those students reach high school. The other piece his comment reminded me, if you take a look at just the total enrollment comparison trend, and that's, again, enrollment in our buildings, from 2011-12 to now, that's an increase of just over 900 students over that last 6 years. And so I think that sometimes, because we see these incremental changes, not that 140 or 200 isn't significant, but I think when you look at over the last 6 years, that's just over 900 students. And then two, knowing that some of those growths have been more in the more recent years. So I think to just kind of take a look at what that looks like over time.
You brought up an interesting point, George, and it's been something that I myself had a concern with Mark Roffler's numbers. I'm going to take a look at our seventh grade totals, 596. Mm-hmm. Okay. Generally, when we go from eighth grade and we go up to freshman, we kick about 10% above and beyond that.
We didn't pick up as much this year. And I'll go back through then and pull the trends over the last number of years.
But, I mean, we're looking at a high school class.
2 years, over 600.
Oh, easy, yeah.
So, I mean...
In fact, if you look at 5, 6, 7, and 8, just mm-hmm. in general,
mm-hmm.
as they all roll into the high school, they're all going to be at or near 600 or above by the time they get through the system.
And then at that other point as well, you've talked about K-4. Our kindergarten enrollment has been our strongest in terms of we looked at patterns. We've looked at probably 10 to 15 different patterns over the last 10, 15 years. And every time we come back to it, it's that kindergarten enrollment is the strongest indicator of growth. It's the most consistent. And then the K-4 seems to be our strongest indicator of what our kindergarten growth is going to be like.
So we're seeing a strong kindergarten growth.
We're seeing a strong K-4. So we're getting these signals which are saying, look out, things are coming our way. While we're hearing from Mark that they're not, you know, they're slowing down, things are that. So we're hearing two different messages. And I know I've talked with some other board members who are going, well, you know, I understand where Mark's coming from, but I'm not quite sure if that's the case. So, I mean, I want to listen to his numbers. I want to be responsible, but I keep looking at K-4 and I keep looking at kindergarten and I keep knowing how that's repeated itself in the past. So I'm really looking forward to you having a second conversation with him. We're right at the point where we have to give some very clear direction to the facilities planning, and it's got to be pretty soon for them to make good decisions. So we're really at a jumping off spot right now, and it's a concern I know I've shared with some other board members here. Wow, are we at the right spot where we want to be as we're making recommendations for the facility planning?
And we'll get APL new numbers in November, but right about the same time we're starting to, you know, narrow in on our options. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I just had a question about Mark's projections and. I mean, maybe we see a drastic change.
Lori Ford. Yeah. So Sarah Litke did send those to us, and Lori forwarded them to Mark Raffers, and he didn't, I mean, I think he thought the timelines were pretty similar to what they are now. When he had told us that, we were expecting that to be like a 3-year gap, kind of. But he had responded, are you pulling that up? I'm
pulling it up. Keep talking.
Here.
I think he didn't think that was off significantly from what he had.
Okay.
So maybe it's some of that had started shifting when he had talked with those builders. And so
here we have it here.
Timelines weren't drastically different from what he thought.
Yeah, he kind of felt, well, maybe one was like a year earlier, but he had already factored it in. And so he concluded with... let's see. Okay. I can't find it. But he basically concluded, like, I'm staying with these numbers, that I had already factored those Viridian developments in. But what I'd like to see, that's why I mentioned the APL report, because he actually uses the APL report as a basis and also then launches off of that. If APL is shifts quite a bit to see then what that does to his numbers, but we all know it. I mean, whether it's 950 more students by 2030 or 1,200, either way, we know we have issues. And so at least this board is very aware and is going to do what's necessary to meet the needs, you know, for our kids. So,
right, because there's building on all three of the elementaries on the east side of the
It's just hard to see those basements being dug. And then have a hard time understanding that we're going to see a decline in
of family homes too.
Right. It's a concern because when I look at those numbers and do a little mental back, you know, check myself, it puts to me, I have a concern whether or not the numbers will justify a new elementary school at Pope Farms. But at the same time, I'm seeing this growth and we're seeing K-4 and I'm seeing kindergarten and I go, wow, if we don't have an elementary school, we're going to have some major problems. So it's tough. So we have to depend upon the people who are giving our numbers. But now some of the concerns that have been shared to me by other board members are now being shared by the numbers we're starting to see. So I'm hoping that we can get answers and answers quickly, because we really are at a tipping point right now in terms of making good decisions. Because if you look at our timeline, you know, November isn't that far away, and then it's 1 year from that point. So certainly decisions have to be made based on a set of numbers that we do all consider comfortable.
Yep.
Again, I don't want to just speak out for myself, but I know I've talked with other board members here regarding not quite feeling comfortable with those projections.
A 20-acre parcel across from that Viridian neighborhood by Bozen that's going in. So, I mean, that's going to be developed too. I'm
and sure. Lori's at the Village across Plains, because you all didn't hear it specifically, but they're looking at the PI property potentially, and that's why she's there to hear what they're saying about that. And then the other one is, you're more familiar with.
It's up on the top of the hill. It's a smaller development.
Smaller, but the PI one would be a large one. If that goes quicker than anticipated, that could be
the one up on top of the hill. They have to go to well water because they can't get a water tower up there, which means the lots would be larger and smaller development in terms of numbers. But still, the PI property, they can do it with existing sewer and water connections that they have.
The town is doing that Viridian neighborhood with wells right by Sunset Ridge.
Yeah, that's, well, at least got to be half acre or something like
that. No, they're doing high capacity.
They're doing wow. So, okay, well, sorry, but
the last. The last town of Middleton meeting I went to just a week or week and a half ago, Viridian is already lobbying the town board to try to allow higher density in an intergovernmental agreement between the city of Madison and the town of Middleton, where it's been that way that there was an agreed upon density. Now Viridian is already begging for 25 more lots just for this one relatively small subdivision, and I'm sure that trend is probably going to continue as they ask for higher density, which is in our school district means more houses. So even, you know, Mark Raffers can look at some of the IGAs that he based his projections on before, and it's not necessarily accurate because those IGAs are being petitioned to be to have variances. So you know, even the density with what we thought was going to be there already is getting thicker, possibly.
What we're seeing here is something we've all understood in the past. There's a great desire for people to come into our school district for multiple reasons. One, we have a good, high-quality school district, and we have a safe spot for them to raise their children in. Those are two very important factors for people when they're moving. Why did you move to Middleton? Why did you move to Cross Plains? Why did you come to a place where I could raise my children safely and make sure they had a good education? Those parameters haven't changed.
Yeah.
And I think as time goes on, it's becoming more and more important. So, yeah. I guess I'm just raising a concern that I think has been voiced by other board members as well.
Yeah, and I shared it with Lori today. I said, I don't know. They don't have math behind it, but I wonder, we might have a little different factor here because of the desirability of the district. I know Mark applies general formula, but I'm not always sure if we fit the general formula. I'm not sure because of the high desirability that people really come here and maybe even the Wanakees and some of the others that are near here. It may not be the same across the state as it is in a few of these communities. So I don't know. So my guess is to be more, I would kind of lean towards there's probably going to be more than we anticipate. So kind of one of our guiding principles was, you know, build enough. I mean, we all agreed to that. And so I think we need to stick with that principle.
I know it's getting late. Just one real quick point. I just wanted to kind of look at the, and I know I mentioned this the last time, Sherry, but looking at the seventh grade numbers for Glacier and Crimery, I just want to kind of lobby again for next year to maybe have us consider adding another section, at least at Glacier for seventh grade, because I'm looking at the sixth grade numbers, which are actually a little higher sixth grade numbers for Glacier than they are for seventh grade even. And if we go from 11 sections currently sixth grade at Glacier to down to 10 sections for seventh, that's going to balloon it up. And then looking at Crimery by comparison, the sixth grade numbers are significantly less for that. And then you go up to 12 sections for seventh grade. So it makes, you know, less pressure, less problem there. But I'm just worried about the sixth, having the same problem next year for seventh grade that we have currently.
I'm going to comment
so
on some of the overloads.
We look at the sectioning by cohort too. So for example, say like there was a bubble class at fifth grade and it was 12 sections at one of the middles. That's what we would roll forward to sixth grade. Like we wouldn't, and say if the current year sixth grade was 10, like we wouldn't keep it 10 because that's what's there. We adjust it for the numbers rolling forward. The other thing in regard to middle school right now is we have heard about one particular class concern, but we're taking a look at where our enrollments in sections and kind of where do we think we are budget-wise, to see if there are places where we need to make some incremental adjustments in terms of an additional section or something like that. So I had Tori also pull enrollments of every 5-8 class, and then kind of so we can take a look at that between the two middle schools as well when we meet on Thursday.
So in that case, I just wanted to point out, then it's not like adding a body, but it might be add 2/10 for math, and it may add 2/10 for science, it may add 2/10 pieces and parts that will lower the class sizes. You won't see it on this chart,
right,
but they'll feel it in the classrooms.
Because they don't, once you get into the, you know, kind of past fifth and sixth grade to some degree too, it doesn't distribute evenly. And so what happens is there become bubbles where like maybe some math classes are running larger or some, you know, because sometimes classes run smaller too because of when students make their on-course selections and things that impact then who's in which sections.
Oh, and it's interesting, I'm looking at the fourth grade numbers. We're at what, 276 right now for Glacier Creek for fourth grade, and that moves up into fifth grade. We're at 246, 270, 269, and that 230 are actually our smallest group leaves eighth grade.
Correct.
At that particular point. And then, so not so much just the capacity, maybe not just on the classrooms, but also the supporting structures as well, the lunchrooms, the hallways, the things like that. Those will begin to be taxed because we're going to kick it up an extra 10, 20% on that next size group. Yep. And then the groups behind it. So we definitely, as we start moving forward, as board members, we look at this and we see this as well. We see the numbers. And then again, I go back to the kindergarten K-4, because we're not building. When we make the approval for this referendum, it'll take 3 years to be built and it will go into place. And then that'll cover for the next 6 to 7 years at that minimum point. We're building for 10 years from now. So that means you go back and you look at the second and third grade and you see where they're at going through high school and kindergarten. We're building for the kindergarten class that's coming up right now. So those are something that we need to look at. We're seeing the largest group of kids that we've had coming through the school system at this particular point, based on what we're seeing in kindergarten. So just as we move forward, it's something to keep in mind. I struggle again with Mark's numbers versus what we're seeing. So not an answer, but a question more so than anything.
Me too.
Okay, I'm sorry, Sherry. Okay, discuss topics for September 25th board meeting. The agenda committee met before the finance committee meeting, and we had some very good suggestions come forward from different board members, and I want to thank everybody for that. And actually, based on all the suggestions that came through, we are looking to make sure that every one of those topics is being identified and being brought forward in some point or manner, either through future agenda items or through a response from the administration. But what we did come up with was a vision for what the MHS campus concept might look like as the one is for a topic for September 25th. So I think we're pretty unanimous in that respect. And I have to agree with you, and George and I talked about, we're hoping that's what everybody else would see, because that's still the biggest question mark in my mind, because there's so many different factors moving forward. Mm-hmm. We've been so ambitious in this concept that I can't even put my head around it, so I'm hoping the administration can move forward. So we're talking right now, September 25th, 6:30 to 8. We'll do what we've done in the past for workshop development, and then George, you can perhaps, because you've already kind of planned for this ahead of time.
Yeah, I can give you just a little. We will make sure that Sherry, Jill, Steve, Laura, other folks that will all be here, we'll all get up to speed on the partnership prospects. We'll all get up to speed on programming ideas. We'll all get up to speed on the kinds of facilities we might want that really lend themselves well to public-private partnerships, community use, and we want all of us to just brainstorm, throw ideas out, share some of the things we've been thinking about. What new ideas do you have? And that will put us a step ahead of FPC, because FPC meets on the very next night. And so it gives you a chance to really get your input and thoughts and ideas out there. So I think that's a great topic for kind of a one topic night. And as Bob said, we will find places for all of the other topics. I may ask some clarifying questions, things like that, but all of the other ideas will be brought forward as well.
This is a quick one. I'll just kind of go through it. A primer on what to expect next summer in regards to that. Talked a little bit with Findorf, and then also Todd mentioned WSB. George is going to take care and find out information.
Yep.
We're not the first group who's ever asked this question before. We certainly won't be the last. George is going to find out information from WSB, present it to us as a board, send it to us an email. Most likely we'll talk about this, I think Annette had mentioned, probably closer to May when we talk about it. But there's no reason why we just, that information is pretty commonly available. Get it off to the board members so you have it and put it in your email so you can start processing in the back of your mind what you can. The other one was lack of opportunity for child athletes to participate in scholastic sports. January, I think.
And Steve and Jeff, we're going to add to the high school presentation, which I think is in January, just a little bit more conversation on athletics, activities, intramurals, opportunities for more and more kids to participate that maybe don't get to play much or don't make teams and things like that. So that'll all be folded in. I'll update you on that.
Then we had drug, tobacco, and alcohol education. We saw in March.
Jerry, I thought an item on what is our educational program for drug, alcohol use. What were the other ones? Drug, tobacco, alcohol, education. So we'll be talking about bringing the board up to speed on what is taught, when it's taught, how it's taught. I figure pupil services, that's probably part of the, I'm guessing, you know, counseling curriculum and other pieces. So we'll talk more about that.
And the other item was, how can we attract and retain minority teachers and staff? January.
Yep. Yeah, we thought January, February, right before the hiring season, we'll have Tabitha and the team come in, talk about what our efforts are to recruit a diverse staff.
And we had a question on if there was a change in Title IX, was it?
Yeah, Sean and I meet Friday, and I want to clarify Sean's recommendation, and then I'll bring that to the agenda setting committee.
And, you know, if anything, if it's just an information that just has an answer to it, perhaps you could send a response to Sean sure. with a CC to the board so the board can see what that is. Okay, so in that particular case, unless there, my apologies, we kind of talked about it like it's fair, but does the rest of the board have an objection to us talking about that on the 25th? Okay, my apologies for just kind of assuming that was okay. Items for action, approval of memorandum of understanding for CBITS. Okay.
Move approval.
Second.
Questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Approval of Godfrey and Kahn payment.
So moved. Second.
Not participating.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed. Thank you very much. We had this as a placeholder, and thank you very much for bringing that up. Was there any possible resolutions for a WSAB convention? I do serve on the Policy and Resolutions Committee, so if something does come up, please let me know if something I can present. Okay. All right. At this particular point in time, I'll need a motion to, I think we have to do this a roll call vote, move into closed session. Need a motion to move into closed session. Okay. Kelly?
Aye.
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 Okay. 2 or 3 minutes just to get everybody settled. And
yeah. I mean, the topic will take 2 or 3 minutes.
Yeah. We're almost done here, folks. I'd be able to catch the end of the second Monday night game.
I know.